My name is Gerardo García. I'm going to introduce a little bit of OSM and the way network functions and network services are modeled in OSM. This session is fully theory. I mean, there is no practice around it. Also, you will see some examples of descriptors just to illustrate well, the way OSM works. And just first of all, just to mention that the slides have been slightly changed 1 hour ago. So, well, there could be a small differences if you have downloaded before the session. Let me show you here. It's about 1 hour ago they have been changed. The changes are not big, but if you want to follow the slides at your desktop, please download them. Okay, from here, I will copy paste the link to the Slack channel. Okay. Well, so just a quick summary of where we are in today's session. We are here, this session three of the first day, and then we will have other sessions related to SOL 006, NFB SOL 006, and descriptor translation. Sorry, and also you will continue checking your environment with Mark, and later on in the afternoon we will talk about primitives. So let's move on again to the presentation. So, well, most probably you all know what NFB is about. Network function virtualization is a mean to make the network more flexible by, in principle, by allowing to define the network nodes by software. So the intention is that to separate the function from the capacity, so you could have a pool of standard high volume servers and switches that could evolve, and you could make it grow as needed when the capacity is reaching its limit. And on top of that infrastructure, you are deploying the software, the specific network functions. So you are moving from a traditional approach, okay, where you were having an appliance per network function, to a model where you have a pool of servers where you are deploying the workloads, okay, and those are what we call the virtual appliances or virtual network functions typically, okay. So the full idea is that you have the network functionalities running as software on top of that commercially off the shelf hardware. So in principle, the same hardware can be used for different roles, okay? And ideally also the hardware is also shared by the different functionalities, okay? Probably you all knew all this, but well, I think it's good that we recap about that, okay? We are going to see how to model the different components, so it's good that we have a common ground and understanding. Network functions are well, mainly they are one or many nodes, okay, in a network infrastructure that have well-defined interfaces and a specific networking capability. So you know about firewalls, routers, or there could be other network functions more proper from the operator world, okay, like EPCs, IMS, etc. In principle, network functions could be modeled or deployed in different ways. We could have what's called typically a virtualized network function or virtual network function, or could be a pure cloud native network function, or it could be a physical element. That's what we call a physical network function, or an hybrid network function. So that's the reason why you typically see in some contexts is VNF, like a virtualized network function based on virtual machines, or CNF based on containers, or PNF based on, and that's the traditional appliance, okay? An hybrid network function that could be a mix of them, okay? So this picture here tries to illustrate the different types of network functions according to the composition of that network function. We could have a BNF consisting of several VMs. Okay, in this context, we are calling them the VMs. We are calling them VDUs. It comes from virtualized deployment unit. DU is deployment unit, and V is from virtualized deployment unit. It could be also every the container-based network function could be based on containers. In this case, in OSM, what we are allowing is the deployment of Kubernetes application. So that's why the concept of KDU is introduced in OSM, okay, to be able to, well, when a network function is consisting of a set of KDUs, is what we call a CNF, okay. As I mentioned before, it could be also consisting of different physical elements, okay, that we call physical deployment units or PDU, or it could be a mix of them. That's the case of an hybrid network function that could be consisting of PDUs and KDUs or PDUs and PDUs, etc. I see that there are some questions, but I think that all of them are from the previous session, so we can move forward. Please, if you have any question, please post it in the chat or also in Slack. Okay, I will check Slack right now. No comments. So that was the network function. So we can take those network functions and combine them together in a topology of interconnected network function, and that's what we call the network service. So the network service is mostly a topology or a scenario of interconnected network functions. And the idea of the network service is that you define it and you model in an abstracted way, so that that definition is agnostic from the place where the network function will be deployed in the end, or the different network functions will be deployed. And when you later on deploy them in a set of VMs or clouds, let's say you are particularizing it with some parameters that are specific for those network function instances, like the specific IP addresses that you want to use, things like that. Okay, so you need to understand that there is a difference between the definition and the instance. Okay, in the same way, like in programming, you have classes and objects, or let's say instances of a class. Okay, when you are distinguishing always between the definition, let's say the pure definition, and the actual instance that is run. Here the same, right? The whole point of the network service is that this is the single unit of deployment, and it's deployed and operated as a whole. So you could have a network service consisting of a single network function, and that could be the simplest network service, but you could also have more complex network services composed of different network functions, and they are deployed and operated always as a whole. What's the YouTube streaming channel again? No, there is no YouTube streaming channel. There is, for the questions, is the Slack channel. The Slack channel is open source mano.slack.com. Here, where you could check it. Also put there the questions, or here, okay, if you prefer.
Yeah, for YouTube, the videos will be posted there, but it's going to take a few days, weeks, okay? So we'll be made available, but not this week.
Yeah, thank you, Silvia. Yes, exactly. All these sessions are recorded and later on are posted in YouTube. Okay, you have in YouTube already the sessions from previous Hackfest, and in this Hackfest it will be the same. Okay. And well, examples of network services could be, well, LTE, VPN, or, well, examples in general, it's any kind of topology that where you are joining together different network functions that are interconnected. Well, so those are the pure concepts of network function and network service. Now let's talk about OSM and the relation of OSM to HCNFV. Well, this is the picture of HCNFV architecture that most of you are probably aware of. So in the NFV architecture, there is a layer that is the NFV infrastructure layer, that it's the one here. You have computing hardware, storage resources. Sorry, there's somebody here that is not mute. If you could mute, please. Well, I have mute all. Okay. So the hardware resources, the infrastructure, say computing, storage, and network resources. There's typically a virtualization layer where the hypervisor is used to offer a set of virtualized resources, virtualized compute, storage, and network resources. That it's what we understand as a virtual machine. Okay, that's the NFVI, okay, or NFV infrastructure layer. Then there is a virtualized infrastructure manager, that it's the software that is used to create the virtual machines, interconnect them, etc., that interfaces directly with that infrastructure, those hypervisors, etc. An example of that is OpenStack, or any Google Cloud Platform, or any other, let's say, infrastructure that offers an API to deploy virtual machines and interconnect. Okay, that was the main idea. And on top of that, we have what we call the management and orchestration layer, okay, on top. When in fact, the Veeam is part of the management and orchestration layer, but this is the pure new thing that is added in NetCNFV, okay, besides the VNFs, of course, that is a set of management capabilities, okay, to be able to abstract the virtual machines into network functions and network services, okay, thanks of some descriptors that we will see, okay, that allows us to abstract those virtual machines and let's say see them as traditional network nodes, although they are virtualized in the end, okay, but as traditional network nodes interconnected one each other, okay. And OSM, Open Source Mano, is a Netsy hosted project that is in charge of developing an open source NFV management and orchestration software aligned with the standards defined in Etsy NFV. And well, it fits specifically here, okay, in this, and it also enhances it with other things, okay, but it's in the NFV architecture, it's placed here. So there is a question already. Is, do you implement the Orb VNFM according to the SOLT 003 REST specification? So here in OSM, we are providing a software. So these are functional blocks, right? The NFV orchestrator and VNF manager. So here in OSM, we are providing a platform that is encompassing both functions at the same time. So this interaction is internal, and therefore we follow the, let's say, we are not following that internally, okay? We are, let's say, structure the interaction internally in the way that we want. So we are offering the same external interfaces. So we are offering SOLT 005 for the interface for the orchestration, so for the deployment and operation of a network service. And we are also interfaces, well, in the interface with the Veeam is following the reference point. There is no specific standard about that because we are using, reusing whatever the clouds are providing, okay, and that would be all. So if the question is whether OSM can talk or not with external VNF managers, it's possible for that. There were some tests about that in previous plug tests, I think, and the way to implement that was based on modeling the external network functions controlled by a VNF manager through a kind of PNF or physical network function, and having a software that allowed us a charm, okay, that you probably don't understand yet, to interact with those network functions. So answering your question, Joao, since we are implementing in OSM the NFV orchestrator and VNF manager in the OSM platform itself, we are not using that specification, but if we want to talk to other external managers, yes, we can, okay, and we are doing that through a charm, okay? That was the way it was done in the past, okay, for the practice. OSM and NFV are different organizations in Etsy, but they complement each other, okay? Etsy NFV is the industry specification group that elaborates the specifications on network function virtualization, and Etsy OSM is an open source group developing a specific stack aligned with the architectural framework and the information models and the specifications in NetCNP. Okay, so OSM, what is doing is following the specifications for the API to the OSS and BSS, and also to the BNS, for instance. We could follow SOL 002, okay, in order to talk to that. This is something that is not yet covered, the SOL 002 specification, but we are right now working on that. We are fully supporting the SOL 005, the Northbound API. We are also following the definition of the descriptors in IFA 11 and 14 that are right now modeling SOL 006. So we are also following them. Well, so that's the purpose of OSM, okay? Trying to do a develop a stack that it's aligned with HCNP specifications. So, well, for those of you that are not fully aware of the NFB architecture and specifications, this is a kind of map that comes from Etsy, from HCNP. You have here the link to that, okay? I have highlighted with these three different colors probably the most relevant ones from the point of the external interactions, from the point of view of OSM. We have, for all these specific reference points, we have stage two specifications. So it's a kind of description in document of the expectation of the different interfaces and information model. That's what IFA group in Etsy NFB is doing. And we have also SOL or solutions specifications that are the specific it's a specification of the implementable protocol and data model solution. So IFA is more like I would say document, okay, describing the interfaces and all the aspects, okay, of that reference point, okay, and SOL is the actual implementable protocol and the data model solution. So as an example, in this point here, that is the interface to OSS and BSS, we have IFA 13 and SOL 005. So OSM follows SOL 005. And regarding the information model, we have IFA 11 and IFA 14 for the descriptors. And we have SOL 006 as the implementable protocol and data model solution for those descriptors, and we are following that SOL 006. And there is also a structure for the packages, SOL 004 and SOL 007. And we are currently not supporting that, but we are in the process of supporting it. It's part of the things that are under development right now, and hopefully will reach release then. Okay. Well, so that was the introduction to Etsy NFB. Now let's, and the network NFB in general, network functions, network service, relation of OSM to Etsy NFB, the Etsy NFB architecture. Let's move to the OSM itself, okay? OSM is mainly a model-driven network as a service platform. So what does it mean? So first is that it's a platform that allows you to create networks as a service and to manage them conveniently. So it's offering you an API so that you could create network services and deploy them. Okay, so that's what OSM is doing through that SOL 005 Northbound API that is enhanced also with some lifecycle management calls and also some calls to be able to deploy network slices as a composition of different network services, okay, that might be shared or not. Based on that, on those requests, OSM what does is mainly talk to different domains. It could talk to the different clouds or VM layers to deploy different virtual machines. Could talk also to Kubernetes clusters. It's not shown here in this picture, okay, to be able to deploy on those Kubernetes cluster specific Kubernetes application. It could talk to the SDN domain inside VM to interconnect virtual machines that are using SRIUV or pass-through interfaces, or it could even interact with one infrastructure manager to create connectivity between network functions in different VMs. Okay, always the idea of OSM is to be able to offer those capabilities through abstraction. So we are not handling, we are not, let's say, from the OSS and BSS, we are not using the concept of virtual machines, but we are using instead the concept of network function and the topology of network function that we call the network service, or even an upper layer that will be the network slice as a composition of network services that could be shared or not. There is a question here, what is the difference between a network service and a service function chain? Well, I think that the question, Tanisha, might is well answered by Mark. Let me give you just a little comment, okay, here, is that in the very beginning of NFB, okay, there was a mix between the understanding of network service and service function chaining, okay, because in some contexts, it was understood that the network service was including some kind of service function chaining, okay, and I think that right now, we all in the industry are considering network services as a, let's say, an aggregation or topology of network functions. In the very beginning of NFB, that was the case. There was some confusion about those terms, okay? In fact, the term network service is not probably well-suited because it's commonly used in network operators, okay, for other purposes, okay? But, well, that's what it is. So, now, I think that this next two pictures illustrate very well the idea behind the abstraction, okay, in OSM. Is that in OSM what we have are network function packages, that means kind of files, okay, zip files with lots of files inside, okay, and those are the packages, okay, and those packages contain mainly two kind of information, okay. First information that those packages contains, in all the cases, right, for network functions, for network services, and for network slices, they contain some kind of resource description, or let's say whatever is required to deploy the network function, the network service, or the network slice. With that information, when you onboard a network function, a network service, and you deploy that network service, in the end, OSM receives that information. Of course, you first of all, you receive those packages through the MBI, and then you receive an action to instantiate them. So thanks to a set of different Vim connectors, OSM can talk to different Vims, okay, depending on where you want to deploy your network service, and the different VNFs are created in the specific infrastructure, okay? So that's what we call the instantiation and the deployment phase of the instantiation, okay? And all that information that is required, let's say the kind of flavor, image to be used, etc., is part of the descriptor information, okay, that is part of the package, okay? In addition to that information, OSM also embeds in the package the management procedures required to operate and run actions on those specific VNFs, okay? And so in the end, when you are deploying something, you are also, when you are instantiating, you are receiving an action to deploy something and probably to run a sequence of primitives or actions on those VNFs. Okay, so, well, like, I don't know, inject an initial configuration, okay? That's something that will be done at the very beginning. Or even later, okay, when you are already running a network service, you could ask OSM to run an action on a specific VNF or run an action on a set of VNFs, okay? That could be an action at network service level, okay? And those are things that can be done through OSM's northbound interface, okay? And all that complexity is managed by the execution environments, typically the chunks, okay, that you will see. So again, all in OSM is model driven. That means that everything is driven by the packages that are onboarded to the system. That's what makes a network service as portable and reusable as possible. So you have network function packages that are the smallest building blocks, let's say, that you receive from the vendor typically, okay, that describes the topology, the let's say the different deployment units, VDUs, KDUs, etc. Okay, in some cases it could be parameterized. Okay, and different actions that could be executed on those primitives for the day one and day two. Okay, day zero, day one, and day two. Okay, and they are provided to you as a package. You don't need to check what's inside. Okay, what you know is that it's an abstraction of a network node that you could deploy. Okay, and you have a set of actions that you could run on top of them. Okay, that's all that you receive. That's the smallest building block. Then you use those building blocks to write your network services. Again, okay, is the network service or the network slice in the end, it describes how to combine those network function packages to create a specific topology or a scenario. And they have also actions for the day zero, day one, and day two. Okay. And then you have those packages. Those packages are the building blocks. They are like templates. Okay. When you instantiate them is where you are, let's say, specifically deciding the target beam or the location where the different network functions will be deployed and the different values for the parameters like IP addresses, keys, etc. Okay, that you want to use. Okay, you are making it particular to a specific to the specific point of presence or set of point of presences where you are going to deploy your instances. Okay, so the idea again is that we are receiving packages, okay, from the vendor, that those are the network function packages. We are building network service packages, combining them together, okay? And in the end, we are instantiating them. But until now, they are always the same. So they are portable and reusable. But when you are instantiating them, you are making them particular and you are saying, I want to use, and I want to deploy this in this specific cloud with these specific parameters, etc. Okay? Is it clear? Okay, now let's talk about OSM information model. So in the end, all that logic is embedded in the package, as I mentioned before, but it's mainly written in a file that it's called the descriptor, okay? And the information model is the code, let's say, or the schemas, okay, that define the different descriptor templates. And there are descriptor templates for network functions, for network services, and for network slice templates, okay, for those three elements. OSM information model is based on Jang. For those that you don't know what Jang is, well, there's an IETF here, is a way of modeling network elements, and we are following that because it's one of the specifications that is followed by CNAP, okay? In fact, OSM is derived from SOL 006, which in turn, as I mentioned before, derives from IFA 11 and IFA 14, okay? And the information model from OSM is derived from that specific SOL 006 model. You will see more information about that alignment in the next session. Okay, SOL 06 alignment is available since OSM release 9, since December 2020, so it's right now part of the release. And in fact, we have decided to follow specifically SOL 006 and not to allow the previous model, okay, because we want convergence in the model, and I think that that's the way to promote it. Okay. Questions? No? Well, for those that there is a question from Francisco Romero, will you expand on the advantages of OSM over Kubernetes, please? Well, yes. I think that it's different, right? Kubernetes is the word orchestrator is used for everything. So OSM is an NFV orchestrator, okay? NFV orchestrator with additional functionality to support operations on those network services and network functions that were deployed, and to allow some, and also to deploy and operate a higher abstraction layer that is the network slice. Okay, that's the difference. Okay, so well, in the end, is mainly an NFV orchestrator as defined in the NFV architecture. Okay, with additional functionality as I mentioned before. Okay, for instance, to operate the network service, we have the capability to run primitives on VNFs and network service level, and we have also the capability to to deploy network slices. Sorry, to deploy network slices. Okay. Here, in fact, the OSM information model is the additions that we are doing to SOL 06 are clear of the kind of things that are added with respect to a common NFV orchestrator. Okay. So, for instance, we are adding the support of physical deployment units. So, a network function could be consisting or could consist of physical elements and virtualized elements. It could also consist of Kubernetes applications. Okay, we could also model network slices, day one and day two primitives at VNF and network service level. And also we are able to model or we are able to deploy a specific data plane workloads or network functions. There are some enhancements that are not present in SOL 006. So I hope that we have answered your question, Francisco. So in the end, when we are deploying a network function that is based on Kubernetes, that could be the case that someone has already a KDU, okay, or a Kubernetes application. When you are deploying that in a Kubernetes cluster, typically you are contacting the Kubernetes cluster and deploying there in the simplest way that you can. Okay, so we are here not replacing Kubernetes. We are letting, let's say, Kubernetes managing the life cycle. Okay, as it's doing. Also, we can also interact with the Kubernetes cluster to run specific actions to those Kubernetes applications. Okay, we will see more about that tomorrow. Okay, just in case you are interested, okay, there is a section. Go ahead. Is there any question? Okay, no. There is a section in the user guide that is the this one here. It's about the information model. This is the user guide. Okay, in the user guide you have here a set of contents. Okay, interesting contents: how to install, summary of the architecture, how to install OSM, the setup of the VIMs, a general chapter about how to deploy your network service, etc. Okay, and also some annexes, and this one is the one related to the information model. So here you have all the details of the information model. You have navigable versions of the OSM information model. So for instance, if you want to check the script or here, the VNFD, this is the example of the VNFD. And you could check it, see the different fields here. Okay, that you have in the network server, in the VNF, sorry. And you have also the details of the model in our repo in Git. Okay. Here, where you have everything that we have in the model. You go to models, you have the augments, are the augments with respect to SOL 006. Okay. And here in this folder, you have the old model. Okay.
Come on.
I'm going to mute you guys because you are talking. Okay, thank you. There is a question. Does OSM only work on regular cage cluster or just in Minikube beams? No, in any cluster. I don't understand the question. Yeah, it works in any cluster. So it doesn't work it could work with Minikube, with cluster deployed with Rancher, with anything. I mean, it's interactive with the Kubernetes API, so there is no need to have a specific cluster. Okay, the Kubernetes API is the same. Okay, it doesn't matter if it's a Rancher or the canonical Kubernetes or a Minikube or Microcage or any other, even OpenShift. Okay, OpenShift adds other APIs, but in the end, it's also offering a Kubernetes API. Okay. And there's a question also, what is the significance of SOLT 06 standardization? That's a pretty good question. I think that the significance is that to try to have a standard that is followed, and therefore the packages that are provided by the vendors are the same to all the operators. I mean, it doesn't make sense that for every orchestrator we have a specific package and a specific descriptor, so that the vendor needs to, let's say, model them in such a way that they could work with a specific orchestrator that an operator has. Okay, the idea is that we need to have a common way of modeling. That's why standards exist, right? So, answer your question. The significance of the standardization is try to enable the reuse of packages as much as we can. Okay. There is also another question. Does OSM provides for BNF's health checks, or scalability as Kubernetes provides for containers? Scalability, you mean capability to scale BNFs? Yes. The capability to do some health checks for BNFs, there is right now it's not provided, but there is a feature in progress trying to be able to work on those kind of alarms. I think that I don't know if there will be some kind of mark. I don't know if we are going to show anything related to alarms here or not. I don't think so, but well, anyway, this is kind of work in progress, okay, in general about the health checks of BNFs and the way to monitor the health of the BNF, right?
Yeah, we're showing scaling and triggering action on alarms, but we're not specifically getting into alarms.
Okay.
But that's tomorrow during the wiki session.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Mark. When adding a Kubernetes cluster into OSM, does the Kubernetes request you to channel support? No. Here there is a mix of understanding. Okay, when you are running or deploying something in Kubernetes, you need the Kubernetes API. Okay, you will understand tomorrow. Okay, I will give that session. So all you need is a Kubernetes API. That's all. Okay. Well, there is also a requirement of having some kind of load balancer. Okay, because in the end you need to be able to offer the capabilities or offer the services that are running your Kubernetes clusters through a kind of IP address, right? So it's not something isolated, right? Finally, just for completeness, okay, on the OSM information model on 006, I have also included here a link to the ETSI, SOL 006 Young definition that it's in ETSI GitLab, okay, here in ETSI NFB GitLab. Okay, and you will have more details, as I mentioned before, in the next session. So now let me, there is some confusion when some people attend to the Hackfest, okay, and they see OSM. In the end, I think that I'm seeing that they are not understanding the different time scales where things happen, okay? And I have included this slide for this Hackfest in order to help you understand a little bit better the different stages, okay? So there are, from my point of view, there are three different stages in the use of network functions and network service packages. First is the design time, okay? Is the stage where you are designing your network function or building your network function descriptor and your network service descriptor by using the OSM information model. Okay, and also you are adding day one and day two logic to complete the package. Let's say some software to be able to run actions on those BNF and network services. And obviously, as part of that design time, you test your packages and you deploy them for testing, etc. But once this design time finishes, there is, let's say, a provisioning time is where the onboarding happens. Is that you, let's say, onboard the network function packages and network service packages to OSM, and there is a package validation and an actual upload of the descriptors and artifacts, the package itself, right? That's the provisioning time. And then we have the runtime, is where you are seeing your BNFs and network services in action. That I would like to distinguish between the instantiation and the operation, okay? The instantiation is where you are, let's say, deploying your network service, and you are also adding day zero and day one configuration. By day zero, I mean that there is a minimal configuration that allows a BNF to be reachable, okay, through a management interface so that it's possible to do some configuration actions on it. Okay, that's the day zero. And the day one are those specific set of actions that are done once the network function is reachable, okay, and accessible. Okay. And it's during the instantiation where the operator decides in which bin to deploy the BNFs, okay, or the network functions, and what instantiation parameters to provide. It's not that information is not added in the design time, it's not added on the provisioning time. It's always added in the runtime. Okay. And also there is a second part of the runtime that is the operation where you are able to run specific actions on things that are already run. No, testing packages, no, I cannot elaborate more. I mean, I understand when you are designing or you are, let's say, doing a network function package or a network service package that you want to distribute and use, you will typically test them, you will deploy them, and you will make sure that they are working well before you pass those artifacts, those packages, to others to use them, right? So as a network function vendor, I understand that you are writing your descriptor, you understand how to do it, and you are passing it when it's ready to be delivered, right? And the same for the network service, right? That's what I mean, okay? Where do the instantiation parameter come from? External inventory? No, it's part of the information that is sent to the normal interface of OSM. I think that your point makes all the same. I understand that it could be ideal that we could relate the network services with a set of parameters that could be fed so that you could, let's say, I want to deploy this network service with this specific instantiation parameter file, okay? And that's not included in OSM yet. It's a feature that we have discussed, but not yet added. So for the moment, that external inventory needs to be handled independently. So you will have to have an external inventory with the different instantiation parameters for the different deployments that you are going to do, okay? In the end, it's a file that you pass it, okay? But you need to have it that way. That definitely makes all the sense to integrate it more closely, let's say, to OSM, okay? And there is a feature about that, but it was not done yet, okay? So now, that's just very quickly, that's the summary of OSM, okay, information model. So how network function network service are model is an OSM? Well, first, a network function. A network function is model with a package, and a package consists mainly of two things, the descriptor and other files, okay? And this is the structure, for instance, of a package, okay? The descriptor is this one, virtual PC BNFD. This is the one that you will see in one of the examples that you will see in this hackfest. And then you have other files, okay? Charms, health charts, well, day zero configuration files, checksum files, well, other files, okay? Here is a different picture for the same thing, right? You have BNF, you might have a topology of that BNF that will consist of a set of BDUs. For instance, in this case, two virtual machines, two BDUs, interconnected by an internal virtual link and exposing some interfaces through external connection points. Everything here in this picture, this topology is modeling the descriptor. Okay? The descriptor, in fact, contains two things, that specific orchestration information, the topology, and let's say all the details about the image, flavor, etc. that I want to use for that specific BNF. And also the management procedures, the set of, let's say, primitives for day one and for day two. Okay. In addition, we have a set of artifacts, the charms or the execution environment that are the, let's say, the all the software logic that is in the end running the action on those primitives. Okay. And well, the other additional metadata is mentioned here, okay? Here we have, this is an example of a BNF descriptor following SOL 006, the new model, okay? And well, the descriptors are written in YAML, that it's a markup language that is a JSON, let's say it's a kind of JSON. In fact, YAML is JSON, so everything that is written in JSON could be read by YAML, okay? Not the other way around, okay? And it's more legible than JSON. So typically you write them in YAML and not in JSON, right? And it includes, as I mentioned before, a topology description, but it could also include scaling group information, so things that should be scaled or not based on some specific parameters, other monitoring params, reference to the A0 configuration file, the list of execution environment that can be used, the A1 primitives, the A2 primitives, etc. All that is in the descriptor, okay? And container-based network function descriptor, is it different from a VNF, a virtual network function? Well, it's slightly different. In the VNFs, we had the VDUs, the set of virtual machines, and for each virtual machine, we have, let's say, the different interface that we are going to use, etc. Okay, so it's just, and in the case of the CNF, a container-based network function descriptor, the things that we are including is slightly different. We are adding the set of KDUs, okay, that could be based on a Helm chart or a UU bundle. We will see that tomorrow. Okay, so please wait until tomorrow, since you will understand better what you can deploy, okay? And also some requirements on the case cluster, because you could have a requirement saying, I want a case cluster of a specific version, or if I want a case cluster that has a single net or two nets, okay? Because for instance, I want to expose my services in one network and others in a different network, okay? A PNF is slightly different also, because instead of the traditional VDUs, you have VDUs that have this field here, the PDU type. So the way the PNF work, you will see that in one of the sections, is that you will have to register the available network elements, the PDUs up front, and you will later on add a network function descriptor, a network function package, saying that you want to use that PDU, okay? The reason why we are modeling in that way is that it allows you for two different use cases. One is where you have a single, let's say, one PNF with a single PDU, but there are other cases where you might have a pool of PDUs. It doesn't matter which one you are using, okay? And you are saying that you want to use only one of those PDU in the context of a network service, okay? That's the reason why we are modeling in that way. Well, a network service package, network services are also modeled with a network service package that is mainly a descriptor and other files, very similar to the VNF, right? You have a topology of the network service consisting of two VNFs interconnected each other. Okay, that's the topology, that's part of the descriptor. The other part of the descriptor are the day one primitives, sorry, and day two primitives. Descriptors are also written in YAML and contain that topology description, the list of execution environments, the primitives, etc. And finally, network slices. Network slices are very similar. Network slices are written in YAML. Well, in fact, the network slices, the descriptor is called network slice template, okay? And they are also written in YAML and contain the list of network slice subnets that are in the end references to network services. And this is important, that's what makes a network slice different, is whether they are shared or not, okay? And obviously those subnets could also be interconnected or not. If they are shared, what it means is that whenever we are deploying an slice and there is a segment or a net slice subnet that is shared, we are not deploying it again. We are reusing it, okay? And only some specific day one actions are done on that. Okay, and that's all. And I hope that you find it interesting. There is more information about OSM here in this link. There is also a user guide here, and obviously we have Slack.